Hello and welcome to Encouraging Financial Conversations. This video will serve as an introduction to the topics and materials covering that we'll be covering in this program and will help you to think about how to begin to prepare yourself to make best use of this program. My name is Amanda Kura. I'm the Sauk County Human Development and Relationships Educator, and I'll be one of the educators helping you learn as we go through this program, and I will turn it over to my other colleagues who will also be working with you on this program.
Hi, I'm Bev Dow, and I'm with UW Extension out of Grant County, Human Development Relationship Educator, and glad to be here today.
And I'm Chelsea Wanicki. I'm an extension educator in Richland County and will also be one of the presenters. Thanks.
Hi, I'm Ruth Schrieffer and I'm an extension educator in Iowa County and also happy to be one of the facilitators for this series.
So now that you've met the four of us, we're gonna go ahead and share the first introductory slides or information that will help you get orientated to the program. All right, so as we begin, we'd like to introduce you first to the learning objectives that we'll be going through as we move through the course over the next couple of weeks. So we want you to be able to discuss the components of financial capability. We want you to be able to recognize the competencies related to financial capability. We want you to be able to examine the factors related to financial well-being. And we want you to be able to analyze a client's financial capabilities, strengths, challenges, and resources. And we want you to be able to identify the resources for financial education within your local area. So those might be different for each of you depending on where you are, what organization you're with, and what kind of program you're offering to your clients. So as we come together over the course of the program, there are some basic ground rules that we want you to keep in mind. So we want you to be able to share your knowledge. The more you share, the more everybody learns. So again, each of you will be coming from a different perspective. You'll have different ways in which you're working with individuals, different clients that you'll have. The more that you share, the more all of us learn. As people share, we ask that you keep things confidential. We also ask that you don't share specific personal information of any of your clients. Hopefully most of you know that by now. You've all worked with client confidentiality before, so that's probably nothing new. But again, it's just a good to remind that we want to be able to keep not only our clients' information confidential as we share, but what we share over the course of the program stays within the program, okay? Respect when people share. So we don't always have to agree with what everyone shares or everyone's perspective, but we do need to respect the fact that they are taking the opportunity to share their experience, and we do need to respect that vulnerability because it's not always easy to share our experience with others, especially if we don't know them. Okay, so please let's offer each other that common respect. We want to ask you to remain open to new ideas. As we talk about money, money is a very personal thing. Plus, everyone has different experiences and is starting from a different place financially. When we talk about money, it's really difficult not to bring in our own personal experiences, our own professional experiences. So as we think about how we want to help our clients, we are going to ask you to think a little bit about some of those experiences you bring to the table. We want you to be able to remain open to learning a little bit about yourself and your own connection to money, and to be willing to think about some new ways of approaching that. Have fun with it, okay? We're going to be thinking about, some new ways to learn about money. We're in any kind of learning environment, there's an opportunity to learn new things, and learning can be fun and enjoyable, and we ask that you do that with us. And then lastly, what else do you need to support your learning? So being very clear with us as educators, please, when we ask you to fill out exercises or help us by answering questions, that helps us to determine what it is you need to make the most out of this program. We want you to be able to get the most out of your learning and make the most of your time so that this is quality learning for you. So please, help us to help you make this the best learning opportunity possible. Helping professionals play an essential role in building individual financial capability. Okay, so the work that you do with your clients helps them in lots of different ways, right? When you get the link for the video for this class, you probably already got a link for a packet of worksheets as well. So feel free to maybe take a moment to kind of orientate yourself to those worksheets. There will be opportunities throughout this video for you to utilize those worksheets to kind of help facilitate your learning. As we talk about the role of financial education, there are a few key points that we kind of want to point out about financial conversations. Financial capability is important for all of us, right? So when you see the circle and we think about the individual, their family, the community, and the society that surrounds us all, financial capability is important to all of us for a variety of reasons. An individual's well-being, their choices, are influenced and affected by areas outside of themselves, their relationships to their family, their relationships to their community, that could be their neighborhood, it could be their faith, it could be a number of different things, and to the wider, broader society is affected, okay? Helping professionals are a big part of that equation to help support systems and connect to resources. So although sometimes we think one individual's decision about their finances really doesn't impact the greater society, the knock-on effect can be pretty impactful. And we're starting to see that more and more in our current society, how small little changes have big ramifications for us politically and economically. Frequently, when we work with vulnerable populations where financial issues often arise, we start to see how small individual things can impact a family in multiple different ways. So when a family doesn't have good financial resources, we can see how this impacts their housing and the stability regarding housing. We can see how it impacts their food and nutrition. We can see how it impacts their lives in lots of different ways, and it can become a snowball effect. So being able to have good, stable conversations with people about their financial capability can kind of open up a lot of different areas for our clients. We often have a relationship or a trust with a client, which contributes to being able to discuss those financial conversations. So as we get to know our clients or the people that we work with, we want to be able to build that capacity to have those financial conversations where they're going to feel comfortable and able to talk to us about the things that they're struggling with. And as we talked earlier, everybody has a different relationship with money. So being able to build the capacity to have those conversations is really important. So why is it important specifically to build financial capacity? I talked a little bit about some of the key factors that impact individually all the way up to maybe socially or culturally or globally. Well, we want to help our clients move toward financial security by working with them on their current status. And that means we have to start where they are, right? So an individual moves up the ladder, kind of a couple different ways here. And when we start where they are, we start by providing that kind of economic support, moving up through self-sufficiency and stability and helping them to reach that security, okay? And you can see on the right side of our slide, it looks at building that through assets. We help them by building assets, right? How do we do that though? So the slide is a little 2D, two-dimensional. So let's have a three-dimensional conversation about what does that look like. Maximizing income by using public and private support networks. Okay, so helping people expand their support networks, helping them understand who and what is out there to help them reach their financial goals. Okay. Self-sufficiency refers to being able to provide for household needs out of current income and resources. People are usually living paycheck to paycheck a lot, and we find that more and more. Some of the studies that have currently been done, we realize that more and more Americans are living paycheck to paycheck, more than we thought. And some of what we've uncovered in recent times is how many people are living paycheck to paycheck. And that's something that we want to be able to help people get out of that situation and have more economic security. Stability could mean that there's an emergency cushion of extra money in the bank in case a paycheck isn't there. So again, that's being able to know that if the car breaks down, if a child gets sick, any of those kinds of circumstances, rather than being cash poor or being overdrawn, that there is a reserve of money that can help through those situations, and they have that to back them up. Finally, security refers to having financial reserves for a longer term, such as retirement savings. So, that longer term security, being able to plan for the future. Maybe it's helping a child through college. Maybe it's putting themselves through college. That's what a lot of us are trying to strive for, is being able to meet those really longer term goals and getting where we want to be financially. And sometimes it's often the thing that we feel is the hardest or farthest out of reach. As one moves up this ladder, it involves asset building, such as money in the bank, a reliable vehicle, a home, a retirement account, etc. So helping to establish those assets helps us move up that ladder. So just some statistics to help us understand the picture in Wisconsin a little bit better. We know that many people in Wisconsin face financial insecurity. So a lot of these statistics probably aren't new to many of you, but it's important to kind of look at them and understand them a little bit better. We know that about 47% find it very to somewhat difficult to cover expenses and pay bills. That's a pretty high number. That's just under half, right? 29% pay the minimum due on credit cards. And we know that when you're only paying the minimum on credit cards, it gets really hard to overcome that debt, that credit. In order to kind of pay down on that debt, we know that you have to be able to pay more than the minimum. So people are kind of just ending up cycling through in that constant debt or that revolving debt over and over. 46% do not have 3 months emergency savings. So sometimes we talk about, well, how much is important to have for emergency savings? And we've heard 6 months salary or a year's salary. And those are really nice goals to have. But when we look at the real statistics of what people actually have, 46% of Wisconsinites do not have even 3 months worth of emergency savings. That's kind of a stark picture to look at. We want to be able to make sure that people have at least some kind of savings to help them in that, again, that kind of emergency situation that comes up. And whether that's 6 months of a salary or a year's worth of salary, that's not the important part. The important part is that in an emergency, do they have some funds to back them up and help them so that they're not getting themselves into debt or into trouble? 23% have past due medical bills, and 14% have spent more than earned over the past year. And lastly, 39% reported that their spending broke even. Okay, so that last one doesn't sound like a terrible thing, but if that 39% are just breaking even, then they're probably not working on any short or long-term goals in terms of saving. Okay, so they're not working on a short-term emergency savings plans, and they're not working towards building anything long-term. So they're not thinking about those goals that are necessary for retirement, college savings, some of those longer-term things that are important. So we know that statewide, there's a lot of data that's been collected. We also know that there's an opportunity to collect local data. If you have the opportunity to look at the ALICE report, that gives you a picture of what the economic prosperity for your local county will look like. ALICE reports are usually up to date within 2 years. And that will give you a better picture of what the economic picture for your county looks like. It can help you do cross-county comparison, and it can help you start to make the picture for, or develop a picture for how you help the clients in your population. There are lots of other places that you can look. There's the Prosperity Now scorecard as well. And towards the end of this presentation, Ruth will tell us a little bit more about how to find some resources to help our clients. But those are just two specific data-based organizations. And we will put more in the links that go with this video and the materials so that you can look at your specific county area. Some common financial concerns that we want to be aware of for our clients are making ends meet, right? Overdue bills. So those can be anything from being behind on rent, having utilities cut off, having a car repossessed, having lots of overdue medical bills, or even one really large overdue medical bill, or wage garnishments, right? Those wage garnishment, if you're not familiar with that, is when bill collection has gotten to the point where the bill collector has been able to get a court judgment whereby they can have wages garnished from the employee before the payment, before the wages are dispersed to the employee. So a certain percentage or chunk of the wage is actually deducted before the employee sees it. So that can affect the overall household significantly. So that can affect the household budget significantly. Other things we want to be aware of are credit problems and just overall cash basis. So these things are some common issues that clients will face that we want to be able to help them through. We want to understand the root causes, how our clients get into these situations, and how we can help them through them. We want to take a look at this list of concerns and how they impact our clientele and how stressful these things can be. Again, that relationship with money and how it's different for everyone. We're going to start talking a little bit about financial competencies. These skills are a kind of, this is a brief look at the skills that we build over the course of our lifetime to successfully manage our personal finances and tackle those concerns as we build our relationship with money. So it's setting goals, maximizing our income, managing our spending, managing our savings, understanding borrowing, and learning how to protect our money, right? So these competencies we'll talk about in more detail. These are competencies that we all need to know and learn how to do successfully in order to manage our money successfully. And these competencies change over the our life's over the course of our life as we grow and learn and develop, we grow and learn and develop in terms of our relationship with money, how we thought about money when we were, you know, kids is certainly different than what we thought of it when we were in our late teens, early 20s, and probably launching out into life. And what we think about it in our early 20s is going to be different or is different than what we think about it in our 30s, 40s, and 50s as our life changes and what we're going through in our external environment changes. Our relationship with each of these competencies is going to grow and develop as well. So So increasing financial security is not just about financial literacy. So it's not just enough to know about money, what money does, and how to manage it. We also have to know, we have to have good knowledge about our relationship with money and all of those competencies. So I'm going to hand it over to my colleague Bev, and she's going to tell us a little bit more about that knowledge as well as literacy.
All right, thank you, Amanda. So as Amanda mentioned, the older term financial literacy, it just implied that people just needed information, right, in order to manage their money productively. So giving them that information, they should be able to handle that and navigate through that. So the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau now defines financial capability as not just based on knowledge, but other additional factors that build that framework around financial capacity in addition to knowledge. So there's more to just the knowledge. We need to add on the skills and the access to manage our financial resources. So we'll take a moment to look, break down each one of those frameworks. And so we will move on to the next slide that talks a little bit about just the base, which is our foundation. Right, so obviously knowledge, what a person knows, right, about positive money management is really important, and having that correct information that really truly provides that foundation for financial management. So for example, a simple knowledge base might be, well, yes, I have a credit report and I have a score. So people need to know that. And another example might be on your credit card balances. Yes, there's going to be an interest. We will need to pay interest if we don't pay off our credit card balances in full. Or if we overspend on our checking account, then we're going to experience overdraft charges. So those are some basic knowledge things that come along with that foundation. So the next part of the framework has to do with action. So what a person does with that financial knowledge. So they have the knowledge, they have that foundation. So how are we going to put that into action? And it refers to, it's our skills and our ability to use that information correctly so that it doesn't lead to financial mistakes. And if we were sharing an example about that, for example, if one doesn't challenge our balance their checkbook, it could lead to costly fees. Even if it's just looking online and keeping an accurate rundown of where our money is at so that we don't get overdraft charges. If we are investigating doing a car loan or a home mortgage and we're not investigating the different or comparing interest rates, it could lead to us paying a higher amount than we could have if we maybe would have explored a little bit farther. Another idea would be a person may know to spend less than they earned. So for example, if we don't keep tracking of our spending and then how we're trying to balance the two between what we're spending and the money that we're bringing in. So those are the types of things. There's that knowledge piece there, then how do we put that knowledge into action so that it affects us in a positive way. So moving on to the next part of the framework, which has to do with access. So this refers to financial inclusion and being able to use low-cost financial services. It also applies to the opportunity to use our knowledge and our skills. For example, an individual may have great money management knowledge and abilities, but maybe not have access to affordable financial products. This could be in relationship to maybe its physical location, maybe it has something to do with their past credit history, or maybe it's they don't have internet access to different products like online banking, so they don't have access to some of those resources. And also, we've heard the term a living wage, so maybe an individual may have limited access to a job that pays a living wage, which affects the overall access. And the last piece of the framework has to do with influences. So there are both internal and external influences that can support or hinder our financial capability. And an individual needs to have confidence to apply their knowledge, their financial knowledge, but the confidence without enough of that knowledge base can also lead to financial mistakes, such as higher interest rates, borrowing would be one such example. Or they may have had a bad experience with a credit card or a checking account, so they never want to use that product again. Or they may have had a habit of online shopping when they're stressed or bored, very similar to some people eat more when we're stressed or bored. Some people shop or do online purchases when we're stressed or bored. So that may lead to making spending decisions that don't fit their priorities. So as we're looking through this framework of financial capability, we all operate within the context of our overall environment. So the type of environment that are surrounding us. This may be a time for us to think about how does racial and socioeconomic inequalities, how do they exist in our clientele that we're working with? For example, it could be around their income, wealth disparities between different ethnic groups due to maybe institutional racism or policies that are put into place that make it more difficult. There was a recent study that showed financial institutions located in communities of color charge higher fees. College entrance bribery scams by the wealthy. Those are just a few examples of institutional or racial policies within a community. So those financial conversations need to focus on the person and their capability within their environment, within the external and internal influences that are around them. So you might ask, you might want to think about what are some of your policies within your organization or policies of level of change or advocacy work that could help clients, and what about some of the financial services and things that are out there that's helping or hindering or setting barriers for families when it comes or individuals when it comes to financial capability. Okay, and I will now turn it over to, is it Chelsea?
Yep, I'm ready. So we're going to do a little bit deeper dive into some of those individual factors that influence financial capability. Three that we're going to highlight are numeracy, self-efficacy, and self-control. So some of those things that help people feel more confident and that they are working toward financial capability, or some things that might need some bolstering if they're an area where people don't feel very confident. So when we talk about numeracy, we're talking about the ability to reason and apply simple numerical concepts, having skills and confidence around numbers, and being able to apply logic to data and concepts. And I'm sure you can imagine if you were working with a client who had a history of feeling like they had low numeracy, feeling like they have some challenges around doing math, that could be a barrier to them moving forward in their financial capability. So here's an example of kind of a fun little riddle that I'll give you a minute if you want to try on your own, an example of what numeracy is or how we put it into practice. So a pond starts out with one lily pad, and by day 30 is completely covered in lily pads. The number of lily pads on the pond doubles each day. On which day is the pond half covered with lily pads? So I'll give you a moment to think about that and jot it down. And I'm sorry if I'm triggering anxiety from having done your SAT many years ago or something similar. So think about it. And the answer is day 29. So if they double each day, then the day before it was fully covered would be the day that it was half covered. But it's sort of a tricky one. Often people are thinking about, if it's fully covered on day 30, then it must be half covered on day 15, because that's halfway between So just an example of numeracy, and I don't recommend, you know, giving these kind of tricky quizzes to your clients, but just a way to break it up and think about it a little more. We'll go into a little bit more about numeracy on the next slide here. just some of those approaches and things and ways to think about numeracy when working with your clients. So what are the approaches? You know, as a practitioner, providing simple tools and calculators, you know, so we have an example here from mymoney.gov where there are links to some of those calculators and budget tools and things that can help, you know, put it right in front of them to keep it a little simpler. And we recommend also, you know, helping the individuals do the math. I mean, it's great if they are the type that likes to sit down with a calculator and add up their own stuff. But if you're sensing that there's some, you know, barriers there, some hesitancy just based on the numeracy and the math, you know, then don't feel bad about helping them do it. You know, it's not our job at this point to like get them to have basic math skills. It's to help them with their goals and what they want to do. And on that sense, you know, also being willing to focus on goals without the math. So kind of shifting that focus to the person and, you know, what is it that you want to do? What is it that would make you feel more confident with your money? And not, you know, drilling them on the dollars and cents around that, if that's just going to give them anxiety and turn them off of kind of the numeracy side of it. So another individual factor that influences financial capability is self-efficacy. And you may have heard of that before or maybe not. What that has to do with is an individual's belief in their ability to achieve goals. You know, how confident are they that, you know, actions that they take are going to result in outcomes that they want? And there's a lot of history and things that can go into whether someone, you know, feels a strong sense of self-efficacy that, you know, yes, if I work for things, they turn out the way I want, or if they have a history of feeling a low sense of self-efficacy that, you know, no matter what I do, you know, it's not going to change the outcome or it's not going to get me to where I want to get. So that is an individual factor in, you know, how people can work towards financial capability and some approaches there to help increase self-efficacy or to help them build up that internal locus of control, that sense of control about what they do, acknowledging strengths. So, you know, just focusing on the things that they're doing well, pointing out those past successes. So saying, you know, wow, that, you know, you accomplished that. That must have felt really good. How did that make you feel? You know, that's a great example of, you know, where you did something using your strengths. And reframing challenges as opportunities. So, you know, if they're starting to feel overwhelmed and that, you know, everything is just coming out at them externally, kind of reframing that in terms of, you know, well, what can you do, you know, and what do you have control over? And how can this be an opportunity and not just a challenge? And then the third one that we'll focus on is the sense of self-control. That is another individual factor that influences financial capability. And on that next slide there, it's got the approaches and just a little bit more about what you would think of self-control. I guess we end on this one because sometimes I think people over-focus on self-control. There can be that tendency to think of, you know, everything with money is just about willpower. And if you could just, you know, control your spending, then you'd be all set. But there's more to it than that. But self-control is still important as well and is an individual factor. So yeah, just having that practice and ability to delay gratification so that you can stick to a goal, you know, to see that long game rather than just doing that initial thing. And that ability to regulate emotions, thoughts, and behaviors. Some of the approaches that you can use for those are kind of asking, you know, do you want help, you know, with, you know, your accountability and, you know, that's something that I can help you with, or to be that person that gives you reminders, you know, having them kind of identify what their self-imposed barriers are, you know, what are the things that you want to put in place to help, you know, keep you on this path so that things don't throw you off. You know, there's always going to be temptations and new things that come up when it comes to money. So how are you going to have those barriers, and who can be your accountability and check-in? And maybe it's not, you know, the helping professional or me as the one who's operating as their financial coach or their financial counselor, you know, maybe it's someone else and they can identify that of, you know, well, I'm going to, you know, call my mom, or I'm always going to, you know, check in with my cousin every time I want to go shopping because she's really good at telling me no, you know, thinking about who are those other people who can help you with your self-control and helping them identify that. So now we're going to switch to talking a little bit about financial well-being. And financial well-being is the ultimate goal of financial capability efforts. And there's a really interesting study that, you know, they talk to a lot of consumers as well as financial counselors and coaches and, you know, got a sense for what are the underlying factors that individuals cite when they feel more positive about their finances. You know, what do people say gives them that relief from stress, that feeling of confidence and financial well-being, you know, and just studying that to see, are there some commonalities between the knowledge, skills, and attitudes and behaviors that contribute to that? And what can we learn as, you know, financial educators or helping professionals about the way we approach our financial capabilities education to help foster those things. So some of the details that they pulled out of that are summarized in this circle diagram that's kind of split into four wedges of the pie. And so I think it's good to remember that these are kind of equal wedges of the pie. So it's not that, you know, being able to cover your day-to-day expenses is 90% of it. It's split into these four different areas. And just to talk a little bit more about what these mean in detail. The day-to-day expenses, as I mentioned at the top, that is maybe kind of an obvious one, but it is just knowing, you know, what money do you have coming in? What do you have going out? It may involve having a written budget or it may not. It may be somebody who is able to track their day-to-day expenses using their calendar or something on their phone or just in their head. But they feel comfortable, you know, knowing that their bills are going to get paid because they know when money's in and when money's out. The unexpected expenses, if you look to the left of there, there's always going to be things that pop up, whether they are health emergencies, car breakdown, something in your house going wrong, a friend or family member that you have to help out. I even put, you know, the holidays here, even though they're not unexpected, you kind of know, you know, every December there's going to be some extra spending or whenever your holidays are that you celebrate. So they're not unexpected, but they're unusual. And so how do you handle those? Do you have a plan for them? Is it money in the bank, or is it a way that you know you can tap into a line of credit, or you have insurance to help cover if you have a large expense, like a medical expense? Just kind of having some sort of plan that eases that financial stress to know if something unexpected happens, this is where I'm going to get the money, this is how I'm going to handle it, and I have a plan. You look at financial goals just right across from that one, and that's often something that, as you know, financial educators or helping professionals, we are wanting our folks to articulate what their financial goals are. So yeah, just knowing that you have a financial goal and also having some steps or a plan in place to work toward those goals, to be able to see some progress. So you can see how these things fit together. If you just have one of these, you're still going to have a fair amount of financial stress. But if you can start putting them together, you start to feel that stress melting away. And the last one that maybe is the one we don't think of right away is the freedom of choice. Is having a little bit of extra money or some wiggle room to spend some money on the things that you want to do or that are going to give you happiness and enjoyment. The ability to afford not just your needs, but some of your wants as well, is really critical to financial well-being. And often that can be what gives people, you know, the motivation and interest in working on those other parts. Because if people feel like, you know, no matter how I slice this, you know, I can't afford to do anything that I want, that can be really demotivating. So if you are working with folks, remembering that them making room and having a plan for some of that freedom of choice, so that if they do get invited to go out to a dinner with friends, or you get invited to a wedding, or something that you really want to do and is going to give you joy, that you have some room in your budget to make that happen without putting at risk, you know, those other three parts of the pie, the unexpected expenses, the financial goals, and the day-to-day expenses. Being able to have room for all of those things and comfortably fit gives you that sense of financial well-being. So now we're just going to switch gears a little bit to talk about the financial capability conversations and what some of the moving pieces are that might be part of those conversations. And of course, this is an intro video to our whole series, so we'll be going into more detail on these things over time. But just remembering that, you know, the successful behavior change, if someone wants to change their behavior and maybe start saving more or pay off some debt, it's going to take more than just knowledge and information alone. There's these other components like action and access and influences. You know, you can think about something that you've maybe tried to change behavior on. It doesn't necessarily have to be financial, but you know, if you decided you wanted to start exercising more, or you know, you were going to start flossing every day, or something that you wanted to change a behavior on, you might know, like, oh yeah, you know, my dentist says I need to floss every day. You know what to do, but there's other things in place. You know, what am I going to do? How am I going to get the motivation to do it? Do I need support? How do I feel empowered and confident enough to do it? And then actually practicing it, like putting it into practice, and, you know, staying accountable. So, okay, if I forget, or I don't implement my goal, you know, this day or this week, you know, how am I going to check in and get back on track? So just remembering that the conversations that you'll be having are going to probably include all of these different pieces over time. And last for me, I am going to give you the opportunity to either pause and do an activity on your own for a few minutes, or you could do this at the end, or, you know, at a different time. If we were face to face, we would be having a conversation about this together. But in lieu of that, just grabbing a piece of paper and thinking about the clients that you have worked with in the past, or that you're continuing to see, when you think about their financial capability, what are some of the successes that you've seen? What are some things that often come up as barriers? And what are some of the resources that they are either using or maybe missing out on? And just kind of jotting some of those things down, and then thinking about that in the context of your role. You know, are there links that you can provide maybe to some of those resources, maybe to connecting them to some of the ingredients for success? Are there gaps that you can fill? Are there places where, you know, there's just missing pieces that they need a little help filling that gap? So you can do that on your own. And we may have time to discuss that in a future class when we're face to face another time. So with that, I'm going to pass it on to Ruth to talk some about the financial education resources.
Thanks, Chelsea. And the visual you see on the screen right now is a toolkit. And when you think about your own occupation or your own profession, you all have your professional toolkit. And through this, the rest of the series on encouraging financial conversations, Chelsea, Amanda, Bev, and I are going to be helping you fill out your financial education toolkit. So we're going to start with a couple of ideas today. And you're going to find references to these in your handout packet, as well as other readings and other resources that we'll share with you. So the first one is something we hope you bookmark, fyi.extension.wisc.edu/money. And that will take you to our Extension financial Education Financial Capability landing page. And we have lots of different resources there. For example, in that upper left-hand corner, check your free credit report campaign. If you don't know what 2266-1010 is yet, we'd encourage you to go to that website, click on the Check Your Free Credit Report campaign, and find out how to not only check your own free credit report, but to do so all year long. 226-6-1010, and it'll all make sense. Another popular website we have right now is Managing Your Personal Finances in Tough Times. And the pandemic that we're in the middle of right now has really forced people to take another look at their personal finances. And this website has lots of good resources for you. And it's very relevant right now for you and for your clients or your participants. Small savings build big dreams is something that Extension has been working on for a couple of years, but we have new access to really build out that initiative. And it's all about college savings from the very earliest of years. And we know from research that the earlier you start saving, and even saving little bits, really does matter for long-term benefits and higher education. Many of our Extension colleagues are working on a program called Rent Smart, and that's all about tenant education, very relevant to many of your participants, and it's now being offered virtually, so it doesn't require going to a class, but maybe being able to access it on the web. Tax credits for low and moderate income families. This is another good resource just because it helps participants get the most out of the dollars that they are earning. So helping them be aware of the tax credits that they might be eligible for. Money Smart and Head Start. There are other resources in addition to some single concept newsletters that we've been using with Head Start families all across the state, but are also very relevant to a lot of participants in other programs, whether you have children or not. Dollars During Development. This is a literacy program, but it's focused on financial literacy and not just learning about money, but actually building literacy skills. So reading to your children, having good discussions, and starting those money conversations early. And then the last highlight here is Money Matters, and we're going to go on to the next slide and focus more on Money Matters. Money Matters, there are for you and your participants who may be interested in a self-study online website, this is the resource for you. There are several interactive modules, and this tool can also provide participants with a certificate upon completion. So if there's a requirement that there are some assignments or some homework that your participants need to accomplish for your particular program, these particular modules could help you with that. Another benefit with this Money Matters series is that we can help support any participants because we can do a follow-up virtual coaching session with anybody who, say they do the Staying Organized unit. They can let Extension know that they would like, that they have done that module and they'd like to talk to somebody about it, and an Extension educator would participate in that coaching session with them on that topic or other topics too. So that not only is this an interactive way to learn more about money, but there actually could be that personal connection and that coaching that goes along with it. Another resource that we've already referred to is the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, Consumer Finance Protection Bureau. This is one of my go-to favorites for resources, booklets, fact sheets. You can download resources from consumerfinance.gov as well as order in bulk if that's what you'd prefer to do. And one thing that I really appreciate about their resources from the CFPB is that they are very user-friendly, and they are also available in English and Spanish. The next resource that I wanted to highlight was the FDIC. So if you walked into a bank, you know that your bank is probably insured by the FDIC. Well, the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation also provides education materials, financial education materials. And once again, these are very user-friendly tools to add to your toolkit. Personally, I like the Money Smart series. it's on the top of this list here. Quick and easy worksheets to print for participants. And what I like about it is that it's got the background information that I can use or that you could use too, so you understand the basis of those worksheets. And once again, these are available in multiple languages. And the final tool that I want to add to your toolkit today is Smart About Money, SAM, they call it SAM, and it's smartaboutmoney.org. This is another resource from the National Endowment for Financial Education, and it has online self-study materials on a range of topics across the lifespan. So, yep, it's great for you as a helping professional. It's also great for your participants. You could preview and give them some links specifically to topics that they're interested in. So those are the tools that we're going to share today. And like I said, we're going to continue to help you build your financial toolbox. So to wrap up our session today, we'd like you to just take a second, or maybe five, to think about what ideas or resources that you are currently using for your own program related to helping your participants think about and understand their own financial situations. What ideas or resources are you already using? When we get together on our live classes, we'll hope to talk about some of the resources that you're already using, because that will help the rest of us continue to build our resource toolkits. So to wrap up this video, we'd like to say thank you for your interest in our encouraging financial education series and helping us set the stage for our future live sessions. We will share another link for a pre-series video and look forward to meeting you when we go live. Have a good day.